totally forgot to.
Hey everyone, again, happy Wednesday. Let's settle in if we can. And I'm going to be introducing our April Sustainability Challenge, which I didn't have time to on Monday. But this is something that every lab is going to be participating in. Your TA might have already introduced it to you. You can go to the next one. I won't play this video, but it's just if you want, this will be on the BiSci, our Canvas page. So Earth Day this year, the theme is Invest in Our Planet. And what we're going to be doing for the first 3 weeks in April, so technically this week is the beginning of it, is each week there's going to be a theme, and you're going to have, you get the choice to decide what challenge you're going to do that fits for you and your lifestyle. And so for the first week, the challenge is going to be around food. And so picking one thing, whether it's related to your habits, what you're eating, how you're eating, and trying to figure out how it could be more ecologically friendly, more sustainable. So I have a few resources, I have a few possibilities. And then for week two, which will be this upcoming week, a swap. So swapping, again, something that's a part of your lifestyle. Maybe you drive everywhere when sometimes you could walk. Maybe you use a lot of plastic at home and trying to go a week without using single-use plastic. Whatever, again, works for you, it's up to you. And then finally for week three, since the theme of Earth Day this year is Invest in Our Planet, it's going to be around activism. So you don't have to be donating hundreds of dollars. I know I'm not going to be able to do that to a movement that's fighting for our Earth, to heal our Earth, but maybe it's volunteering with your lab or a few people in your lab. Right here in State College, I know I work at ReFarm and at Windswept Farms, and we're going to be planting 250 trees the weekend of Earth Day. So lots of opportunities, lots of possibilities within these challenges, and we're also going to be checking in each week. So hopefully this weekend at the field trip, since we don't have lab, you're able to check in for week one. I know we have a few days, it's not a full week, but something you did revolving around food. Thank you.
Thanks, Lily. All right, I also want to say thanks to Lily and Pedro for doing the food class on Monday. I thought that that was really inspiring and eye-opening and lots of cool connections, so thanks very much for doing that. Sweet. So today we're going to move through a little bit more of this, of part three of the course. And first I sent out a Canvas announcement about this. Tomorrow is our extra credit movie, and it ties directly, particularly to what Pedro was saying about how we sustain the soil and how important that is to be sustaining the soil in order that our food is getting the nutrients that it needs. And this is a really well-done movie. I found it to be just connecting all these pieces and dots that I didn't even know about. So come and take this in. You'll meet Jamie, one of our fabulous learning coordinators there for the movie watching and then good conversation afterward. So that opportunity is available to you. So I want to say, before we get started in the shelter class, that as we go through these, you know, she presented this food challenge to you. The idea is that you can do things where you are now, making different choices, but then there are a lot of things. We're going to talk about shelter today, and I acknowledge that a lot of you might live in an apartment with a whole bunch of people. And so when I talk about, you know, small homes, maybe that's the last thing you want to think about, is living in a cramped space, because that, you know, your dorm room is exactly that right now. But what I'm trying to do is plant some seeds for the future. So yes, what we're going to talk about in these classes are little things that you can do now, but maybe in the future when you have the power of choice, in bigger ways, then you might be able to make those. I also understand that you might be in a really stuck place as a college student. You're not quite an adult yet, and you're not a kid either. You're like stuck someplace in the middle. Your parents might still be saying, oh, you should do this, and you should not do this, and whatever it is. Parents usually have good intentions. But sometimes it can be really hard to be in your place of making choices that are truly yours. So I want to acknowledge that I know that. So when we talk about shelter today, it might be sort of out of the realm of where you are in this moment. But that's okay. A lot of the things that I took from high school, I didn't fully understand them until later in life or get to apply them. So what we're talking about here in part three, is this idea that how can we reduce our ecological footprint while improving our quality of life? And so that's where we're headed today. It's true that about when you did your ecological footprint in lab, that you learned that about one third of our footprint is food, about one third is shelter, and about one third is transportation. So that's why we dive into those. We did food, today is shelter, Monday is transportation. It's why we dive into those specifically to sort of pick apart what all is there. And that's why we're doing it this way, because they have such big impact on ourselves and on the world. A key to all of those things, particularly the food and the shelter, is that we're looking to survive, right? So continuing to live or exist, especially in hardship, which you might describe as where you are a little bit right now, not exactly where you want to be someday, but not where you were, stuck in this middle place. And so when we think about shelter in the realm of surviving, if we think back to our human ancestors 20 or 30 or 60,000 years ago, when humans were just in the beginning stages, we have to consider that our skin is our first shelter. Skin is what keeps us safe from so much, right? From infection, from disease. So skin is our very first shelter. And then what do we put on top of that? Well, a long time ago, it was this, right? Animal skins were then the first covering that we had to put on top of our skin for protection. And so this level, obviously, I'm thankful that this level of shelter has evolved. I'm not a hunter. I am not opposed to it, but I also don't know how to sew deerskin jackets. So I have with me today Joel, who's going to talk a little bit about this. He's been thinking a lot about how we cover ourselves. What do we use for this layer of shelter? So I'm going to pass it over to Joel for a little while.
Hello.
Hello.
It works. Wonderful.
There you go.
All right. Good morning, guys. Good morning. That's what we say back, yeah? My name is Joel. Today I'm going to talk about clothes. You know, it's kind of crazy to think about. Our clothes were like that. I don't know how many years ago. But now you look around and everyone has a different clothes on. Penn State, maybe it's Levi, it's Champion, it's something different. Everyone. And you go downtown, and everyone has a different, I live right by McClanahan's, and I walk by there, and I go in and I check, and it's a different shirt every week. Like for Valentine's Day, there was a different shirt. For St. Patty's Day, there was a different shirt. For Christmas, there was a different shirt. And like family clothesline, different shirts. So I sort of want to know, like, how do you decide to buy your clothes? You guys can talk to your partner real quick. How you decide to buy your clothes?
Thank you.
I'm doing double duty. Lights and sound. So what do people think? Do we have the mics out? What do people think? Go for it.
Personally, if it's me, if I'm not buying the clothing, I choose the most expensive option. But if I'm paying for it, then it's whatever I can find that's cheap.
Okay. What's the go-to? What's the go-to, Jill?
I'm definitely a victim of fast fashion, for sure. But yeah, thumbs down for me. But other than that, like, if I'm not paying, I like Lululemon and stuff like that.
Okay. Snaps? Hands? Anybody else? Oh, yeah, go for it. Oh, go for it. Yeah. Well, there's a mic. Thank you, Peyton.
We were talking about in our group how a lot of times whatever looks best on us, there's so many different like styles of clothing now. So I'll probably go for something that like fits my body type well and that I feel confident in. And a lot of times like maybe that can be more expensive. Or again, you know, like she was talking about, fast fashion is super easy. And if something doesn't fit and you don't like how it looks, it's like, oh, it was only $15.
Thank you. Yeah, I hear you. Jamie, over here.
I feel like I'm very practical. Like, I think about what I can wear new clothing with, of like, what I already own, and money. Like, if it's super expensive, I stay away from it, if possible.
Thank you. Something practical. I think that's true for a lot of people, especially college students. Money, practical. Anybody else? Hands? Anybody? Up. We have one up top here. Go for it.
So, like a lot of people, especially nowadays, enjoy like inheriting clothes, whether it's from like a family member or friends. As long as it's in like, you know, pretty standard condition, you know, a lot of people enjoy wearing like vintage style. So, I think that like rather than either paying for it or, you know, sometimes you might have to pay like a higher expense because it's like vintage and it's in a higher condition, but like. Repurchasing clothes is definitely something that's more popular.
Yeah, especially now. I think with like, there's definitely been like a thrift shop movement, buy stuff secondhand, Goodwill. I agree. Thank you, Kevin. Anybody else up there?
I do like, I guess, replacement clothing is what I'd say. So if I like rip a hole in like my favorite pair of jeans, I'll buy a new pair that are kind of similar or like maybe a bit more trendy. But it's more of like a, if I break something, then I'll buy something that I know that I'll like.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Anybody else? So I sort of want to, we got one more? All right, we'll do one. Oh, let's do two more. You first.
I like the idea of like investing in high quality clothing and then like passing it down to my kids or something one day. So I try to like save up and buy something that I know will last a really long time.
Okay, some quality. Very good. Last one.
I definitely fall into just over consuming clothing and just looking for things that fit and are in style at the moment. But I've been trying to think more about the environmental impact of the clothes I get and like thrifting and things like that. But I find that even then I still over consume because I'll be like, oh, but it's not a new piece of clothing. It's something thrifted. It was already purchased. It's already like out there, even though I don't necessarily need it. So I just kind of impulsively buy things.
Yeah, that's a great point about like sort of, it's usually the first step is like figuring out that you've done something wrong or that you maybe buy too much. You know, like there's a saying, it's just trigger, it's like deceptive marketing, out with the old, in with the new. And I'm just going to show you a video just real quick. It's going to be like 3 minutes. We'll be right back.
influence of fast fashion spread. Zara is now worth $13 billion, with stores in over 93 countries. Admittedly, I've made my fair share of purchases from H&M and Uniqlo, with my favorite being a blue bathing suit I bought for $10 at H&M. $10. How can a piece of clothing be that cheap to make, transport, and advertise? Well, to be honest, it can't. There are huge humanitarian and environmental costs that are hidden by an inexpensive price tag. Although these fast fashion companies have committed numerous human rights violations, today I'm only going to look at the environmental issues that are caused by the mass production of cheap clothes. The phrase fast fashion is used as an umbrella term to describe the accelerated process of turning new design ideas into clothes on the retail floor. In the case of a store like Zara, for example, it takes a mere 14 to 21 days from the inception to the sale of a product. And this ability to create new trends very quickly, combined with savvy marketing campaigns, has meant that stores like H&M and Forever 21 can quickly change every item in their store to drum up hype about a new line of clothing. Much like a fast food chain that is constantly changing its menu items in order to stay relevant, these fast fashion stores can introduce new clothes almost weekly. Not only does this mean that consumers are tempted to buy the newest and best pants or shirts, but it also means that older items quickly become irrelevant. This constant overconsumption has high environmental consequences. On the supply side of the equation, most clothing is now made of a material called polyester, which is a petroleum-based fiber that requires large amounts of fossil fuels for manufacturing. According to Forbes, that number has now reached up to 70 million barrels a year. And the rise of fast fashion went hand in hand with a rise in polyester production. Now, polyester manufacturing for clothing far outpaces other common materials like cotton or wool. This presents a major problem, especially considering that polyester is a non-biodegradable substance. Polyester can take anywhere from 20 to 200 years to degrade depending on the conditions, and is one of the leading causes of microplastics in oceans.
Some people hit on what the video was all about earlier about fast fashion. And this video goes into other things about microplastic and polyester and everything under the sun. So just take a look at for a sec what I'm wearing. Wearing a t-shirt, I'm wearing jeans. It takes 3,000 liters of water to produce one t-shirt. This is about 1 liter. So tie 3,000 of these to my shirt. That's how much it is. It takes about 10,000 liters, between 7,500 and 10,000 liters to produce one pair of jeans. So I'm wearing 13,000 liters of water right now. That's just what it takes to create the textiles. Multiply that by the 500 people in here. I'm not amazing at math. That's like 6,500,000 liters of water. That's a number that we can't even fathom, which is basically, it's the size of 2 water parks. This room alone, just to make clothes. And we need them. What Jen said earlier, we need clothes to survive. You know, the shelter aspect of it isn't just homes, it's what we're wearing. Clothing and our water, we need our water. 20% of our water, our wastewater, is used in just creating dyes for clothes. This picture right here is of the ocean, of people dumping water and of dumping dyes, just what it creates. You could think about how that water could be used somewhere else, in some other way, that we just don't do, we just don't think about, because we're wearing it, and it's not foreseeable. But imagine if we tied the water bottles to our shirts, what it would feel like, what it would look like. A lot of people said, like, overconsumption. That's a lot of clothes. I used to think that I bought a lot of clothes. I remember one time, it was one summer, you know, going through your clothes. My mom said, "You have a lot of clothes, Joel." And I was like, "No, I don't. You never check your closet enough." She said, "Take out everything that you haven't worn in the last 6 months." It was basically I'm like a cartoon character. I wear the same five shirts, and I have a pile of clothes smaller than that, but still a pile of clothes that I don't wear because I'm too tunnel vision on the next thing. Like a couple of weeks ago, we talked about like consumption, and people said like during COVID, like that was what made them feel good. Buying something new. You go down to Penn State, buying a new shirt, it feels great. You're like, you get to wear it for the occasion. You get to wear it out with your friends. It's honestly, it's almost like a bonding experience going shopping at the mall or something like that. But you look up here, and 60 million metric tons of clothes get dumped each year. Again, numbers that are things that we can't make sense of. That's about 60 tons. That's 30 cars stacked up on top of each other worth of clothes that end up each year. 85% of clothes end up in a landfill or an incinerator a year after buying them. That's like, I can't even put a number on that. And then we talk about, in the video, talks a little about microfibers, polyester, and what it takes to make it. 35% of the microfibers that are created in this country are created just making shirts. Polyester, they're cheap. When your shirts get washed, the plastic drains out of it. So that's why when they end up in the water like this, it creates pollution. Just things that you don't think of, like the plastic use. And I don't think of like I'm wearing plastic when I'm wearing a t-shirt. It feels normal. Also, it takes trees to create clothes, to create textile. About 70 million trees per year. That's about like 1/5 of the trees in the Amazon rainforest are used to create just clothes each year. Here's a little bit by the number here. 700 gallons to produce a t-shirt. 4% of the global landfills are filled with clothing and textiles. 68 pounds of clothing by each American each year. Does anybody know this brand? Raise your hand if you know this brand. What do you think of when you see this brand? Let's get some mics out. What do you think of? We can talk. You can talk about it for a sec if you want. Or go for it. Go for it. Wait, guys. Someone's talking. Just be a little quiet. Thank you.
Okay. So when I think of this brand, I think of the problematic stuff that they did. Like they had been selling prayer rugs as like a fashion item. They had sold other problematic items. And I did a little research into them after that whole incident. And just I choose not to buy my clothes from them anymore because of like how problematic they are now and how their clothes are made. And it's just not a good brand in my opinion.
Yeah, thank you. That snaps. Right here.
I think of child labor.
Very good. There's a lot of things behind the scenes. Who here has bought something from Shein? Is it Shein or Shein? Raise your hand. How much did it cost? Someone said $5 right here. $10. I'm going to pull something up real quick, if you guys don't mind. I want you to take a look at the website. Guys, settle down one sec. Some people have been here. You see their ads on Instagram. They're really good. Their marketing is great. That's the sort of the thing that we see here. Clothes are $5, $10. Prices that legitimately make no sense. I saw a guy on Instagram yesterday do a Shein haul of the shirts that he bought. And I assume that the shirts probably cost about $20. And it's just, you don't think of that. You want to show off your clothes, but you don't think about what it takes to make those clothes. Because this is the brand that they advertise, but this is the company itself. This is behind the scenes. Who's wearing Nike shoes right now? Who's wearing Adidas shoes too? Same thing. Same thing. I'm not going to discriminate against either shoe. I don't care what. It's the same idea of how we make our shoes. It's a problem because we don't have a lot of options. I mean, I just said earlier, you know, it's the saying is out with the old, in with the new. But it should more be like, buy local, keep longer, things like that. Because, like, what emotions are coming up when we see this picture? Again, we can pass out mics or something like that. Emma's up there. Guilt. I agree. I'm guilty of it.
It's just really sad.
It's just sad. Thank you. It's sad. Anybody else? Thank you, Snaps. That's a good one. Anybody else? Thank you. It's estimated that 75 million factory workers are in the fashion industry. There's 75 million people like this. Again, big numbers, numbers that don't make sense. So Penn State has a population of 40,000 students. If you multiply that by 1,875, that's about 75 million. 2% of those people live on livable wages. 2%. You don't see it, and I wish that I could, because it's so tempting. You go to H&M, and oh my gosh, it's like beautiful, it's white, it's like, the shirt's $10, I have to have it, you know. The deals are like, you know, great, it's advertised amazing. But then like clothes end up here, like a year later, and you're like, why did I buy that? Anyone ever have like the immediate like guilt of like buying that? You're like, I didn't need to buy that. Raise your hand, it's okay. I happen all the time. I walk out, I'm like, I bought like my fifth Penn State shirt. I'm like, come on. It's another white shirt with blue letters that say Penn State. I'm like, I worked at like the student up at the, for a football game, I worked at like one of the student vans where they sold out shirts. And I saw how many clothes we had in there. And I was like, there is no way that we sell all of these. We sold them in like an hour. They do that every football game. Look at downtown, everywhere. And then like, again, 85% in a landfill. It's just the things you don't think about. So this is the part where everybody goes, what do we do? What am I feeling? What do I do? And it's easy to think about. Usually the first step is acknowledging that there's something wrong. So these are some of the things that we can do. A lot of people made a really good points earlier about vintage secondhand. Kevin made a really good point about buying stuff secondhand. That's a great thing to do. Go to Goodwill instead of going to H&M. Buy something old. Keep it longer. Buy something higher quality. Like the jacket that I came in with, I bought at a thrift store by my house. And I've kept it for like last like 5 years. And I just wear it everywhere I go. But not everyone has, I understand that not everybody has the same relationship with clothing. Some people grow out of their clothes. Some people, like their, it fluctuates how they look, what they think. But it's just taking small steps. Maybe you buy a shirt, 5 shirts every month. Make it 1 shirt every month. Maybe make it 1 shirt every 2 months. Again, it's small steps. Usually lead to bigger steps. High quality and green design. Recycle your clothes. You can recycle your clothes. You can donate them to textile things. They make them into compost. You can also, there's also centers around. Goodwill, Salvation Army. But then there's the part that says, does the clicker work, maybe? Upcycle? This is the part where I maybe embarrass some people. I want my group to raise their hand. I want my TA group to raise their hand. You guys know who you are. I see you right there. Doug's group, raise your hand. Jill's group, raise their hand. Everyone, no, keep their hand up. Keep your hand up. Keep your hand up. This is clothes that they donated. These group right here. They donated a trash bag full of clothes to the Salvation Army. They did it. It was them. Nobody forced them to. I didn't force them to. I didn't put a grade on it. And then we also tie-dyed the shirts, too, to repurpose them. That was the student's shirt. This is what we did. And we made these shirts, and we worked right here. People looked at me weird. People looked at us weird. People asked what we were doing. But we didn't care. Because it's not about that. It's about making something new for somebody else. The person who needs a t-shirt, the person who would like a pair of socks while it's cold outside, a person who needs a new t-shirt. And people came together and did that. And I think that's something to be proud of. And there's other ways, I'm going to go back a couple slides, but there's other ways to do this just besides that. There's the, it's called, I'm not going to get it wrong here. It's called the American Textile Recycling Service, Earth 911. There are places where you can, there are resources to Google, and you can find clothing drop-off boxes, places where you can give your old clothes, repurpose them in a new way. There's other stores that you can do, not big brands. It's just making the small step, because acknowledging that something is wrong is usually the first step. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel.
No problem.
You might want that. So our first layer of shelter after skin, clothes, and then the next layers, right, of the buildings that we create. So again, going back to that, where we started with animal skins, and then quite an evolution to where we are now. This is my house. An American home, right? My house was built in the mid-1800s, actually. And what's happened over time? How is it that we've, you know, obviously it would be really challenging to live in central Pennsylvania in fur huts, and that's not what I'm suggesting at all. But just how what we think that we need evolved. This is how it's changed over time. So in 1950, this was the average square feet of a home was about 1,000 square feet, and they averaged 3 to 4 kids that they fit into that space. In 1970, it was up to 1,500 square feet, and they were averaging 3 kids. And then the year 2000, we were averaging two kids. And now, in 2018, the average American house is 2,600 square feet, and people are averaging more like 1 to 2 kids. So almost 10% of the homes built today are over 4,000 square feet. Generally, fewer people per house and more square footage per person than ever before. So how is this affecting us? What do you think? How is this affecting, how does this go back to the culture piece that we've talked about? If we have more square footage, less people, what do you think? How's it affecting our culture? Go ahead and chat with your neighbor about that. What do you think? How is all of this tied together with culture and space in our homes? There's some folks in the back, if there's a microphone around. Thank you, Peyton. Up in the very back.
Emma and I were talking back here about like how it goes back to overconsumption and greed, and we were saying it's kind of tough because like who doesn't want a big house, and you know that's the culture that we live in, that you know everyone wants a big house and we want to like show off to other people, but at the end of the day like it's not something that we need, so yeah, we kind of talked about overconsumption and greed. I'm passing it to Emma.
And I was talking about how, like, my parents are divorced, and my dad's house is like 3 bedrooms, 1.5 bathrooms. Meanwhile, my mom's is 7 bedrooms, 4 bathrooms. But like my dad's house is like so much more of a home to me than my mom's. So it's just like kind of weird that, yeah, everyone like really has been like wanting to live in bigger houses, but it really doesn't matter at the end of the day. And it's just like greed.
So Emma, can you hold the mic just a second? I have a follow-up question for you. So what is it that makes your dad's home feel more homey to you?
I mean, possibly the fact that like my step family is at my mom's house and like I'm not as close with them as I am with like my actual family.
Yeah.
But like, I don't know, I can just like sit on the couch in my dad's house for hours. Meanwhile, at my mom's, I feel like I'm like glued to my bedroom.
Ooh.
And so I don't know.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know. And my dad's house is a lot older too, and it's just like cuter and has like that homey feel.
Interesting. That's cool reflection. Thank you for sharing that and being vulnerable about that situation. Other thoughts about this? What else? Okay. Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah.
My part.
Oh, sorry.
You can go first.
Okay.
Sorry, Aiden. My partner and I were talking about how when houses are bigger, it's nicer because you get like your own personal space away from everyone. And today in our culture we have today, we think that people kind of like to be separated more than together nowadays.
Interesting. Yeah. How do you feel about that? Okay. Go ahead, Aiden.
I was just going to say, I think it might have something to do with how American culture has changed and how I would say something like the ideal American dream has changed. I think when a lot of people think about what the American dream is, there's this notion about having a house of a certain size, of having a home that's like everyone else's. And I guess when sort of culture has sort of pressed the idea of consumerism and getting more and more and having things that are bigger and bigger, well, over time, it also means that the houses that we want, the houses we like, also get bigger, regardless of how big our families are.
Yeah, interesting. Thanks for saying that. Any other thoughts about that? Yeah, go ahead.
So, just like someone said earlier, I feel like the same way. So my mom's house is like huge, this like giant house, and then my dad's house is more like small and homey.
Yeah.
And so like I feel more like comfortable at my dad's, and then when I'm at my mom's, I feel like it's just like she said, I'm kind of confined to my room almost, I feel like, and like just like being in isolation as compared to being like with my brother or like my mom or my dad, like being with people that I would want to be with.
Intriguing. Thank you for sharing. I like thinking about these things. There's a comment up in the back row, and then go ahead.
I live in a town. I'm from New York. I live in a town where houses are typically really big. And I live on a border of a town where houses are typically really small. So my house kind of falls much smaller than a lot of my other friends. And I like that. I feel like my house is very homey, as a lot of people were saying. It's comfortable. And when I'm in a lot of my friends' houses, it's just too big. Rooms are too spread apart. And like one of my best friends, his house is his room is on one level, and then his parents are like all the way up. And it's like 3 staircases just to get to his mom's room. And I think that's just like too much for no reason.
Interesting. Yeah, behind you a couple rows up. Thank you. I'm appreciating all of these thoughts. This is cool.
I think there's a growing notion that the more we have, the happier we'll be, when that's rarely the case ever.
How does that show up in what you know, your personal experience?
I didn't grow up with a ton of money, so whenever I had the opportunity to buy something for myself, I did. And I realized that I really wanted to buy a lot of things because I thought it would bring me that instant gratification or happiness. Mm-hmm. But over time, I realized that was never bringing me like true fulfillment or happiness in the long term. It was just short term. So I think that's where that comes from for me.
Thank you for sharing. One more. Yeah.
So I just kind of had the thought about my dad's house. Back in like 2012, he bought a older house. It used to belong to a hoarder, but he bought it for really cheap because of that. Mm-hmm. And he's, over the past 10 years or so, he's been doing a lot of remodeling. Mm-hmm. And at some point, he realized that it's like a two-story house, total of three bedrooms, I think. Mm-hmm. Or it was four, but he decided that he really didn't need or use the upstairs. So he just put in a kitchen in one of the bedrooms and basically turned it into a, like, Airbnb because he's gotten really into minimalism and meditation. He's like, I don't need that upper floor. So.
Yeah. Thanks for saying, just thinking about the possibilities. That's something that I'll get to about my house too. So it's really, I think that this reflection is really valuable about what do we really need and what are the effects of how we choose, right? What are the underlying effects of how we choose? And so how does that shape our footprint? And what's the consequence for the earth of having that bigger house? It might be cheaper, you know, old houses, I can speak from experience, it's hard to heat my old house. It was just built in a time when insulation was not what it is now. And yet, is the way that I heat it is a particular, you know, choice. And then, but building a new house instead, then all of the carbon that goes into building that new house, all of those resources that go into building the new house, it might be more efficient as far as heating goes, but is it really using less because the creation of the house is also using all of this carbon? So the idea that the smaller the house, generally, the smaller the ecological footprint. And so really we can go to the extreme. And I'd like you to take a couple of minutes to do this. Imagine, use $10,000 to build a shelter for yourself. You can talk to your neighbor about this, but I really want you to consider your main thing. How does your main thing play in? I think it was important. It was just the right amount that for that topic, I think. So what'd you come up with? Yes, Jason.
So me and my partner went all over the damn place. We were talking about just buying land, and then it just eventually got to like living in an eco village. So I feel like with $10,000, it's so much, like it's so little, but also so much possibility that it's like, it's so overwhelming. Like, I don't know. We had so many different ideas, and then we're talking about, like, living outside of a mountain. Like, I don't, who knows? We just went all over the place.
Fantastic. And like you just said, the possibilities. So can I hear from just two more people, and then we'll, yep. Go ahead.
Is this working? Okay. I would live in a yurt in Alaska. I just think that you would have a lot to do. You could ride four-wheelers, snowmobiles, shoot guns, go fishing. Possibilities are endless.
Absolutely. Yurt in Alaska. That's less than 10,000. Great. Anybody else? But cool idea. Microphone coming. So when we push ourselves to think outside the box, what can happen is pretty interesting, I think. What have you got over here?
I just want to add on to the person who spoke before who said that they would live in Alaska. I think it's really interesting they chose Alaska because a few days ago I watched a video and it talked about how expensive food is there. Like, there was a box of strawberries that were like $20, I think, because it's so remote that the transportation to bring the food into the stores is just like costs a lot of money. So I thought that was really interesting. But I like wouldn't even know where to start with this question. I would probably live somewhere where the weather was like pretty neutral. There wasn't a lot of like thunderstorms or anything like that. But I guess that's where I would start. I didn't like, I don't know. I didn't think too much into this question.
Okay, and that's interesting because it can be also an overwhelming thing. My first response is, why are there strawberries in Alaska? Why are there strawberries in our grocery store right now, boxed in their plastic? How far are they coming? Is it really full cost accounting? And so strawberries in Alaska, it seems like if you're going to choose to be in Alaska, then you're choosing not to eat strawberries. That's just my first thought about that. But going back to shelter, is that it can be done. These tiny homes, the idea that they can be built for $10,000 and then the operating cost, it is way more than $200 a month to operate my house. So you can make choices. The idea is, though, that these people don't have a mortgage. A mortgage is typically 30% of your income over the next 30 years. So the money and the interest and all of that that goes into it is way more than the sticker price of your house. So the freedom that these folks can experience in living in these homes while thinking about the belongings that they're choosing to bring in, it's a really mindful kind of life. And so with that, I hope that you have a beautiful day, and I will see you on Monday. Oh, I'll see you on Sunday! Woo!